Hello there, Di here. I was asked by Maggie today if I would do a short tutorial on how I put together the little flip folder that I sent her recently. And so, that's what this is all about. I don't know if it'll be very quick. It'll probably be rather lengthy because I tend to ramble on. But I've prepared what I can and hopefully it won't take me too long. To make the covers for this, I'm using cereal box cover, and I really like these ones that the boys have been getting lately because they don't have the shiny surface. It's recycled, it's just sort of crafty on the back. It's hasn't got that shiny smooth surface that sometimes you need to rough up with a piece of sandpaper in order to use it or in order to put paint or something on it. So that's what I'm using. They come in small boxes, so they get through quite a few of those, so I've got a fairly good supply. Now, to make the flip folder the way I made it for Maggie, is you need these pieces. What I thought I might do, instead of continually saying the wrong size, whatever, and most people don't need sizes anyway, you know, you make it to suit yourself, you make it as wide as your available cardboard and as high, you make it to fit the postage box you want it to send it off in, you make it to suit the paper that you're using, whether you're using a 6x6, a 6.5x6.5, an 8 inch paper pad to mat it. All of those things come into consideration, of course, along with whatever you want to put inside it, because that will affect things like the width of the spines. They don't have to be very wide if you just need two or three pages or pockets to send photographs or stickers or cards or things like that, flat things. You make it to suit the requirements, and that's where I fell foul of the first one I made. I really didn't have a clue what I was doing, and it just frustrated me the whole way through because I could see that it wasn't going to be suitable. But if you're interested, I will put these over on my blog, the sizes, and just quickly, these two are the same size, so we need the front, what will be the front of the folder, and the back of the folder, and they're the same size. And they're actually 6x7.5 inches, or what's that? I think it's 15.3 and 19 centimeters from memory. This third main panel is the flip bit that goes over the front, and I like to use magnets to hold them shut, and that piece is 19 centimeters or 7.5 inches tall by 5 inches, and what's that, 12.7 I think across for the 5 inches. But as I say, that's just the size I used because of the pieces of cardboard that I had available. It can be as big or as small as you like. Now, the spines are important because that affects the amount of space that's in the book. And I think when I made Maggie's, I made them an inch wide, the spines. This one I've made an inch and a quarter, so it's a little wider on the spine. And I've scored it, so it's 2.25 inches wide, or 5.7 by 19, they're all 19 in length, so 5.7, and it's scored at 1.4 or half an inch. Did I score that at half an inch? Let me see, I think it's 3/8 of an inch. Let me just check that, because this is what I do if I try and give measurements out. Yes, it's scored at 1/2 inch. It's 2 1/4 inches wide, which leaves the spine piece in the middle 1 1/4 inches. So you've got 2 1/2 inch flaps, 1 1/4 in the middle by 19. Actually, while I've got this out, we'll go on to the scoring, because the scoring can be quite tricky if you've not done much with cereal boxes and other recycled paper. Sometimes when you go to score, I'll just go in a little bit once I work out what's up and what's down. And if we go to score this at 1/2, the best way when you're using something a little tough is to do it in gradual increments, not try and do it all in one fell swoop. And in actual fact, this one's going to make a fibber of me. And it's actually scored all the way down. Quite often in this recycled board, you'll come across, as you try and go down, you'll come across a little lump or a little bit that's extra dense because it's been recycled. And the fibres just skew your stylus or your bone folder offline. And it can be quite difficult to score like this. I'll just see if this one does it. Look at that. It's gone off just a tad at the bottom. But it's got there the second time. That's just because I didn't particularly want it to this time. But anyway, trust me, it quite often does not score very easily. That one's gone okay. A way around that is to, what I quite often do, is to grab my, I grab my stamping up tool and using the score tool, I rub that up and down several times. And that just is enough to dent it so that the stylus stays in the groove when you get back to the scoreboard. The other thing, of course, you can do, which is quite effective also, is to get your Tim Holtz ruler, or I like the Tim Holtz ruler because it's got the graduations on it. And you can just line that up on the 1/2 inch line and use a bone folder and go up and down with a bone folder nice and firmly. I don't like using that because very often the ruler slips for me and I don't get a straight score. But anyway, that was just a little tip there, because it can be quite difficult to score on the scoreboard. You can make this from absolutely anything else. Something else I've used is good quality manila folders. The backs or fronts from paper stacks, they're usually quite a nice weight. Those sorts of things. You can even use cardstock if you've got a decent weight cardstock. And if you're matting it with a decent weight paper over the top, that can be strong enough. Without anything else. Now I'll just put the adhesive onto this, making sure I don't go over the score line, because that just wrecks the fold. You want to use a pretty decent adhesive. I quite like using wet glue, but I've got a nice roll of this red tape now, which I got from AliExpress. It's been brilliant, so might as well use it. Makes things a little quicker. And once you put your tape on the side, now you work out what side you want to put it. For mine, I prefer the adhesive and the flap to be on the inside of the folder, so the spine and the cover are flat. This is going to be matted, so it doesn't show if it's as much if it's on the inside. I'll just go back out because I'll end up by not being able to see. Need to just snip these corners out. Get rid of a bit of that bulk in the corner. Helps with the fit too, if you're like me and you don't always get everything absolutely dead straight. I'll start putting this folder cover together. I'll put that over there where I can reach it. If you're using, I've got the glue stick, popping a glue stick smear up the tape just gives it an extra moment or two. Turn it where I can see it. Grab free time. It allows you to whip it off if you need to. That's one side on. You just have to make sure you're getting these in the right order. So we've got the front, a spine. This will be the back. And another spine, and then the front. You have to also consider the weight of the tags and tabs and all the other bits that you put inside, because they accrue very quickly. Is. That's basically the folder done. We've got a front, we've got a back, and we've got a front flap, and we've got two spines. This spine here is where we'll adhere the pages in a minute, and this spine stays free. I'll just press that down a little bit more there, let that set a bit. And while that's happening, well, actually we should really go around the edges. We need to do the edges of this, and then that can be drying while the adhesion is setting itself. Let's clear the decks here. When I did Maggie's, I did around the edge with some gold acrylic paint, but I think in this case I'll just use black, because I'm not sure yet exactly what paper I'm going to use. Let me just go through that for a minute. I've got a stack of very odd bits of Graphic 45. Now normally I wouldn't use anything as nice weight as Graphic 45, but it is just old remnants of pads that I really want to use up, so I'm going to see if I've got enough in there to cover it with nice bright colours. So that's what I'm going to see if I've got enough. But I'll go through those as this paint is drying. And this is basically all I do, is just go over it with a black acrylic paint dabber. Now I'll just let that dry and I'll be back in a tick when I've got some matting papers cut out and we'll go through the pages. Now I'm back. The box is nice and dry. It's looking pretty good. And I've cut out all the mats from the bits and pieces that I think will coordinate the best. And the reason I've selected these colours is, in thinking about what I'm going to use for the pages, I've got these two old manila folders. Now these are a nice, smooth, fairly good quality manila folder. They don't fall apart as much as the other ones that I've got. And I thought these would go inside sort of with those colours better than anything else that I've got there. What I'm going to do now, just quickly, is go around all of the edges of the mat pieces and then I can start adhering them into the folder and putting the magnets. That's the next thing. So I won't bore you with all of this. This is just a simple matter of going around the edges. Certainly not essential. And depends quite a bit on what you're using. I think in this case, with the black edges of the cereal box, it will help just to amalgamate the look. The other thing I need to do once I've done this, and we've adhered, put the magnets on and adhered everything down, is just create the page section and work out if we want any flip pages, which usually you do when you make a flip folder. We'll decide on those once we get to the actual pages. So I'll leave you now. I'll continue this little task. I've inked around all the edges of the matting and I'm just going to start adhering them into place. Seems a dreadful shame to use these lovely double-sided papers, but they have been hanging fire for quite a while, and I think it's time for them to go. magnets need to go there and there before we proceed any further with that. So I'll leave that there for the time being. Is it there actually? Flip it over. There we go. Almost got the folders complete. Let me see. And I think for this one we might put three magnets. Pop a glue dot as close to the centre as we can and adhere it not too close to this edge and not too close to that edge. And what we did for glue dots. Same up here, about the same distance in from the edge, and then I'll just put a third one in the middle. There we go. Give those a good push down. Just add a magnet to the top of each. There are other ways of doing magnets, but this is the way I find easiest because they find their own side. I have been known to try and put them on upside down and they shoot off all over the room. Okay, now we've got those in place, just add a glue dot. That one's being a little recalcitrant. Just to the top of each of those. And they're nice and sticky, and what we can do now is simply fold this over, making sure that we've got it not caught up on that ledge there, but right across, and that the covers are nice and equal and in the right position, and push the three magnets on. Then we can pull this away. There they are, ready to be covered. And just as an added precaution, and I don't know if it's essential or not, but I always do something like this, even if it's just plain sticky tape, but as I've got this out it will do, is just to put a little bit of extra insurance over them. Magnets coming loose, especially if there are young children around who are likely to try and eat them if they come out of the journal. layer of tape doesn't add a lot to the dimension, and it's worth it for the extra safeguard. Down nice and securely, make sure it's well adhered all around the edges and that those magnets are simply not going to go anywhere. Now we can do the same for this. Pressure to make sure again it's well sealed all around those areas where there's magnets and around the edges of the page. There is a little bit of bumpiness there, but it's not that bad. And there it is, clicked together. There's the basis of the folder, done. The variables, of course, are the size of this. You could make this, you could punch this or edge it so that it's got a good shape. You could make it diagonal. You could do all sorts of things with that. I've just done it uber plain. The spines can be covered with lace, with fabric. I think on Maggie's I put a sort of an inch strip of calico and glued that, and that can be quite nice because you can pin charms or bits and pieces in there. You can put a little post, or if you want to think you might put a dangle on it, it's a good time to think about putting that before you put the pages onto the inside. But that's the basis of the box, and I'll go and prepare the pages, and I'll be back once I've got those done. The pages that I'm using was a design that Genevieve came up with, and she took her idea from the Stack the Deck Binding by Laura Dennison for inserting pages into a journal. Jen took it one step further and made Stack the Pages, and it's a very quick and useful way of making a set of pages for something like this. It's just perfect. So I thought I'd use that. I have bought one of her templates, and She's on YouTube as well, so you can go and see that. These aren't her templates. These are just using that idea of cutting out the pages. So that they can stack together. And you do need a good strong adhesive for these. What it is and how you work it out is you have your spine here, and this is where this page is going to attach. So the spine of the page has to be less than the spine here. This was 1¼ in width. So this spine is 1 inch, so that it will fit inside that those fold lines neatly. The second page that stacks inside that, like so, is 1/4 inch on either side, smaller than the back page, and also it's 1/4 inch on each side shorter than this page, because when you fold them up, if you don't trim that extra 1/4 inch off, the inside pages will protrude by 1/4 inch. So that's, you can make them with closer together so that there's less of a gap. We have 1/4 inch on either side once these are adhered. Let me just line that up. There'll be 1/4 inch on either side of the pages, but that gives you a nice bit of depth if you're putting some embellishments in. If you're excuse me, if you're making a page where the gap between the pages needed to be smaller, you could add you know, a couple more pages there, because you would only need perhaps 1/8 inch or less between each size. But whatever gap you have there, you take from the sides as well. So as the pages get smaller, they also get shorter. I'm just putting it on the back because this is what's going to adhere it to the spine once we get them together. I don't know what I've done with my good scissors, they seem to have completely vanished. And I think for this one I'll use wet glue as well as the double-sided tape. Some wet glue on, I won't need to put glue stick. That should give me a moment of wriggle time. Now I have marked the centre of that spine, top and bottom, and the centre of this spine, top and bottom. And what I'm going to do is try and line that up. And also that. Just check that it looks straight there. There. Might need to trim just a tad off the bottom of this, but that's okay. There's the page unit. You can see we've actually got 4 pages. And this is why you need a nice long piece of paper. You could join it and have your tabs folded there, it would add to the bulk at the center. And we're ready to put them into the book. I'm just going to make it a full page. I'm not going to worry about making it any bigger than that. Oh, I have made a couple of flip pages that we can put on the side. And like I did before, I'm going to add some wet glue to this. Once again, to give me a little bit more time to get it adhered and also to maximise the amount of stick that we get. The little glue stick is great for decreasing the instant grab, but it doesn't add anything to the adhesive power. So now I put little tick marks there where the center is, and we need to center top and bottom. So we're looking at the spine, top and bottom, and we're looking at where the center is, and we want that to be straight. We want these pages to lie straight. That one's a little crooked, but that's probably because I didn't cut it perfectly straight. And once you think you've got it as close as it can be, give it a good press down. You want that page section to stay exactly where you've put it and not drop out at the first opportunity. That's not perfect, but it's going to be okay for the purposes. You should have just a tiny little gap between the edge of your spine of your page piece and the spine of the folder on both sides. And it should be centered down and up, so you've got your folder, your pages, where you really want them. Okay, so that's got those in, and I've got a couple of additional pieces here, and I thought I might put a flip page, and that looks like it needs a fraction of the height of it. I'll just do that, I'll be back in a tick. I've just bought a new Fisker's rotary cutter, and I'm having trouble keeping things straight when I cut them. Sometimes we go a little askew. That's been scored, looks like a couple of centimetres, 3/4 of an inch. Just tab those and work out which page we want to put them on. I think I'll put them on the to flap onto the outside of that middle page, and because I'm not matting these pages, you have to work out whether we want that flap on the inside or on the outside. I prefer it usually on the outside like that, so that it's on the back of the page. Seems to work better that way. And if I did that, I would add a pocket over this just to hide that tab. But in this instance, I'm going to put it on the inside. Where's the back folder? put the tape onto this side of the tab. I think this video might be getting a little too long for the boredom, but you know, sometimes you have to just go there with real time. It allows you to sort of explain things better, or for me to explain things. This rubbish. I think I'll put another strip along there. I think the longest part about these things is getting that jolly staticky tape off the back. I might just use some wet glue. That might do it. I'll just put another strip on it. Go, there's one foot pocket, and now we'll put the other one into there. I'll just take another whisker off that. I quite often go to the caterpillar after I've used the new whiskers. It's funny. I think it wouldn't take that much to get used to a new cutting tool, but it is taking me quite a while. I just need to use it a bit more. The caterpillar is wonderful for getting very straight edges. It's you can use it on quite thick chipboard and it cuts brilliantly. It's got a soft sharpening blade and so it just keeps going. I use my little stamping up trimmer for fine paper, smaller items, more precision work. So I've got a good combination now with the big viscous too. Allows me to be precise, and the thing I like about it is it's got both metric and imperial measurements, whereas the caterpillar only has metric. Still, it gives your brain something to do, doesn't it, working it all out. Stop a galloping horse, I'm sure. There we have it. Now you can see there what I mean. When the pages are done flat, they're a quarter of an inch. This smaller page is a quarter of an inch shorter than the first page. But when you hold it up like that, they're even. So there we go, the pages are in. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 actual surfaces to put bits and pieces on. And now we get to the decorating, which is really the fun part. I'm not going to go into too much decorating on this one. I just thought I'd show you a couple of things. Again, it depends a lot on what you want to do with the album. I had a bit of file folder left over that was a bit buckledy and scored on the back, and had some of the score lines that come automatically on the folder. So I've turned that little piece into a pocket, and I thought would be quite good on there. It needs to be fairly flat because there's not a lot of dimension, because these pages go right to the edge of the spine, but it would be fine to pop some flat things into. Wait, I'll start at the top. I've folded it over half an inch at the top, which to me is a good way to start a pocket, because it makes that top edge lovely and firm. Got all these odd folds here, it makes it a little hard. So I've got that flap, I've got this flap. And we've got the bottom flap, which we will push up onto those. And that will make sure that when you're putting things in the pocket, they slip down and don't get caught up on that little flappy tag at the back, which can sometimes happen because it's just trying to slip in, just stick on it. I've gone around the edges of this with black soot distress ink. And don't throw your little bits and pieces away when you're trimming out these pages, because I thought that little off cut, it's only absolutely tiny and would normally not get saved, but I think it'd look quite nice on the pocket, because this is sort of quite graphic colours. I don't have that many edge punches, so I didn't want to do too much fancy work on it. I wanted it to be quite plain. I've got that glue everywhere, but it'll come off with the magic eraser tool. Oh, it's coming off with my fingers, that's good. So that looks quite neat, and it's used up that tiny little scrap. And I'll just trim that. So that's quite a nice size pocket there on that flat piece. You could put pockets and tuck spots, and you can make tuck spots again from quite small slithers. You could adhere that with a piece of 1/8 inch tape, and it would just give you enough to slide something under on the edge of a pocket or bottom of a page. Here's one of the pages I was going to cut up and use and didn't, but that lovely strip of stamps, if you cut that off, that would make a really nice little tuck spot. Or you could cut it off double and fold it and use the back as a tab. Any of these could be cut out and used as a tuck spot adhered down, that'd look really nice. So use up those scraps as much as you can. The other thing that looks quite nice is to use a punch, and this is just a Martha Stewart, and it's fairly, I thought it was appropriate for this folder because it's fairly graphic and makes it look quite vibrant on the page. I hope you can see there. I'm not even checking the camera. It's not a punch I would use on its own, because these are quite frail, and if you're putting things in and out constantly over time, as in a journal, then they would wear very quickly and bend and look a bit tattered. But if you just want to make a decorative statement, and you know, maybe you would put it on the edge of each of the pages, that would look quite nice, and it's got a deep, it's deep enough for you to pop things underneath and make it into a tuck spot, or you can glue it down flat and just use it purely as a decorative. But in this case, I think maybe I'd put one there and one there, because I'm using up these scraps of black paper. It'd be really nice, one on either end, and just to tuck a photos or little flat embellishments or little acetate tags with flat embellishments on them, that sort of thing. So look at your punches and your scraps to see if any of them can be used. The other thing is tags. I had all these things lying on my desk, so I tried cutting out. So last time I made tags, I used a thicker chipboardy thing, and they really were too dimensional to fit comfortably into the folder. So I thought I'd just try one quickly with the same cereal box, the leftover cereal box pieces from the cover, rather than to toss them all into the bin too. Use them to make some embellishments. I think they would make nice flat. I made some flat beads that were very successful. I really like them, and I might make some more butterflies and hearts and bits and pieces. Again, using the leftover scraps from the pieces you use to do the matting. Instead of wasting them, they coordinate nicely that way with the folder. And the glue rubber onto that. Not dry enough yet, I'll get it off after. And all I do is go around. Whoops, you can see that even though that's a new one, it is deteriorating already. It's had a fairly hard life, that little spongy dabber top. It's I really like that whiskery look you get from the less than perfect dabber. I like that whiskery edge you get on things. Before they stick to everything they're not supposed to. And because I had them sitting there, I'll just put a couple of these. I was using these the other day on my heat emboss tags. I've cut a few extra off. So there's a little tag that could go inside. So there we have it. That's basically it. The embellishing part and decorating part is the most fun, and you know, certainly any metallic embellishments would look good on this. Charms to dangle off or to include with the package, that sort of thing. There's lots of things you can do. I hope you enjoyed that little tutorial. And I'll catch you next time. Bye for now.